Morgan Stanley's New York office recently asked this question during their first round interview for an investment banking summer internship. How do you calculate cost of equity? Cost of equity is a concept that often comes up during investment banking interviews because you need to know the cost of equity before you can calculate the WACC, which stands for weighted average cost of capital. And the WACC is a popular concept for interviewers to test you on because it's arguably the most important assumption you need to make when you're doing a DCF, which stands for discounted cash flow. Now, DCFs are used as one of the primary ways of figuring out how much a business is worth. So it's one of the most commonly used analyses in investment banking and also something that is frequently asked about during interviews. So long story short, if you don't understand cost of equity, chances are high that your interview is not going to end well. Okay, so in this video, we're gonna walk you through how to calculate cost of equity, but just memorizing the formula is easy. And that's not what the interviewer is going to ask you about. Instead, they want to see if you actually understand the rationale behind the formula. So I'm going to explain it to you in a way that's so simple, even a sixth grader could understand it. All right. And once you have that aha moment, everything will just click and you won't have to memorize the formula by brute force anymore. Wouldn't that be sweet? Now, if you're new here, I'm Sam, a former technology investment banker at Morgan Stanley. And today I run Wall Street Mastermind, where we've helped over 1,300 students who have collectively secured offers from every single bulge bracket and elite boutique investment bank on Wall Street. With that said, let's dive in and help you understand how cost of equity works once and for all. Now, first, let's take a look at the components that make up the cost of equity formula, which says cost of equity equals the risk-free rate plus beta times the market risk premium. So let's explain each of the variables in this formula. The cost of equity is the return that an investor expects to get when they invest in the equity of the business. One of the laws of investing is higher risk, higher rewards, lower risk, lower rewards. So this basically means that for any logical investor, you're going to have to promise them higher returns if you want them to take on a riskier investment. Conversely, if the investment is safer, the investor would also be willing to accept lower return, right? Because think about it, if you only make investments that are highly risky but has low returns, you will probably go broke. And on the flip side, if you only make investments that are really safe but has high returns, well, that would be nice and that's technically what you should try to do, but it would most likely be impossible because if such an investment existed, then every other investor out there will want in on it and it would drive up the price of that investment, which would then lower its returns. So an example of a low risk investment would be buying a stock of Apple or Microsoft, right? These are two of the largest companies in the world and they have tens of billions of dollars of cash on their balance sheet. In other words, their business prints money and they're not going out of business anytime soon. On the other hand, an example of a high risk investment would be Tesla, right? If you sold your Apple stock and put that money into Tesla instead, you do so knowing that there's a good chance that the Tesla stock price is a lot more volatile and could go down a lot faster than Apple stock would. But you would only do that because you know that Tesla could also go up a lot faster than Apple could. So at least that's if everything goes well, right? So the cost of equity for Tesla should be higher than the cost of equity of Apple, right? And hold that thought actually, okay? I will prove this to you mathematically at the end of this video, so keep watching. Next, let's talk about the risk-free rate. This is basically the theoretical rate of return of an investment with zero risk. The closest thing to a risk-free investment, which doesn't really technically exist, but the closest thing to it would be loaning your money to the government, because the government should always be able to pay you back no matter what, especially if you live in a first world country with a stable economy. So for the risk-free rate, investment bankers in the US typically use the 10-year treasury yield, right? Which is currently 4% as of the time of this recording. Oh, and if you have any questions about anything I've said so far, please drop a comment down below and I'll try to get back to you as soon as I can, okay? Next, let's talk about beta. We have the risk-free rate, which is 4%. Beta is a measure of the volatility of a stock compared to the market as a whole, which is typically represented by the S&P 500 index. So if a stock has a beta of 1, that means that it moves in lockstep with the stock market. If the stock market goes up by 1%, the stock will also go up by 1%. If the stock market drops by 1%, this stock will also drop by 1%. So along the same lines, if a company has a beta of 2, then its stock price will move up twice as much as the stock market, right? So an increase of 1% in the S&P 500 will cause a 2% increase in the company's stock price. And the same thing happens in the opposite direction if the market were to drop, right? Then the stock price for the company would also drop by 2%. right? So as of the time of this recording, Tesla's beta is actually around 1.9, which makes it actually the highest beta or the most volatile large cap stock out there on the market. Last but not least, if a company has a beta of less than one, then its stock price will move less than the stock market, okay? It'll be less volatile than the stock market. So for example, Walmart currently has a beta of around 0.5, which means every 1% fluctuation in the market in either direction will only create a 0.5% change in Walmart's stock price. In case you're wondering, there are companies that have negative betas as well, right? Which means its stock price moves in the opposite direction relative to the stock market, okay? So if the stock market goes up, then this stock price is going down. And if the stock market is going down, then this stock price will actually go up. These are typically stocks that tend to do well during a recession. So for example, gold or gold-related stocks could have negative beta because investors flock to gold for safety when the stock market is doing poorly. I know that can be kind of confusing sometimes. So if you didn't follow some of what I just said about how beta works, again, please drop a comment down below and I'll try to get back to you as soon as I can. Next, let's talk about the market risk premium. The market risk premium is just the expected return you would get if you were to invest in the stock market as a whole, which again is typically represented by the S&P 500. And then you take that number minus the risk-free rate, which we've already covered. So in other words, how much more returns would you expect to get if you were to invest in the S&P 500 instead of something safer like US Treasury bills? The long-term average return for the S&P 500, if you look it up, is about 10%. And as I mentioned earlier, the 10-year treasury yield is currently 4%. In other words, the market risk premium right now is 10% minus 4%, which is 6%. You're getting rewarded with an additional 6% in expected returns if you were to invest in the overall stock market as opposed to just something really safe like loaning money to the government. And now that we understand each of these components, it's easy to see why the cost of equity formula is the way it is, which again, just as a recap, it says the cost of equity equals the risk-free rate plus beta times the market risk premium. So essentially, the expected return you would get from investing in a stock is equal to the market risk premium multiplied by the stock's volatility, and that's how much more you would expect to make versus if you were to just invest in something that's risk-free like the US government bonds. And then remember what I said earlier about high risk, high returns, low risk, low returns? Well, this is captured by the beta of the company. So for example, a higher risk stock like Tesla will be more volatile, right? Which is why it has a beta of 1.9, like we said earlier. So assuming a risk-free rate of 4%, and a market risk premium of 6%, the cost of equity would be 4% plus 1.9 times 6% or 15.4%. So that's Tesla's cost of equity. Now, on the other hand, a lower risk stock like Apple will be less volatile, which is reflected in its current beta of 1.1, which is significantly lower than Tesla's 1.9. So that gives it a cost of equity of the same formula, which is 4% risk-free rate plus 1.1 for the beta times 6% for the market risk premium, which is just 10.6%. So this means that investors expect to be compensated with returns that are 45% higher when they invest in Tesla stock versus Apple stock, right? Due to the higher risk that they're taking on when they invest in Tesla, okay? So at this point, you should have a really good understanding of how cost of equity works and what it means. So the next time you get asked this question in an interview, hopefully you'll ace it, all right? And as next steps, if you wanna see how cost of equity is used to calculate weighted average cost of capital, I have another video on how to do that, which I will link to, okay? Or if you already know how to calculate the WACC and you wanna skip ahead and see how the cost of equity and WACC fits into the DCF calculation, then I also have a video on that, which I will link to as well. Now, aside from that, if you would like more hands-on and personalized coaching with your investment banking or private equity interviews from our team of coaches, that includes the former global heads of recruiting at top investment banks like Goldman Sachs, Credit Suisse, UBS, and Lehman Brothers, then please don't hesitate to reach out to our team. Oh, and if you found this video to be helpful and want to see more videos that break down commonly asked technical interview questions like this in an easy to understand manner, please hit the like, subscribe, and share button so that we know to make more videos like this for you in the future. And as always, remember, nothing worthwhile comes easy, and nothing is more important than your future, so keep grinding.